Hi there, and welcome to The Daily Gardener, a podcast about gardening, botanical history, and literature. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and today is October 5th. Today in botanical history, we'll celebrate a Flemish Renaissance painter who painted the first landscapes, the American naturalist and artist who saved Prospect Park, and an American botanist who jotted down a little poem on one of the pages in his herbarium. It's a little known treasure. And we'll hear an October excerpt today from Barbara Kingsolver from one of her best-selling books. And we grow that garden library with the Bible for trees and shrubs. It's a must-have monster resource. And then we'll wrap things up with the story of the Enlightenment author who captured the work of gardeners and various trades at his own peril. Now, before I get to today's curated news, I just wanted to talk a little bit about some of the little tidbits that I've been picking up as I've been doing the show over the last couple of weeks. You know, a few days ago, I shared the video in the Facebook group of Dan Hinckley, where he was talking about Windcliff. And when he was talking about his inspiration, what had really inspired his vision for his garden at Windcliff was a movie called Enchanted April. Now, Enchanted April came out in 1991, and it's about four women, four complete strangers that are on vacation after World War I, and they end up at an Italian villa. I think they spend the entire month of April there, and thus the name of the movie, Enchanted April. Now, the other day I was driving my son home from school, and I said, John, jump on your phone and tell me, how can I find Enchanted April? Is it on Netflix? Where am I going to find it? He's like, okay, you have a couple of options. You can see it on YouTube for $3. And if you have Amazon Prime, you can watch it on Amazon Prime for free. So watch Enchanted April for the garden, for the background, to see Dan Hinckley's inspiration. And then if you have been to Windcliff or you have his book, or you jump online and you see videos of Windcliff, you will completely be able to see the parallel there and why that movie was such a pivotal piece of inspiration for Dan. Anyway, that's kind of a fun thing for you to follow up on. And then also earlier today, I was on Twitter and I saw a tweet from Charles Birnbaum. He works at the Cultural Landscape Foundation, and he just shared a video that they did with the Southern California landscape architect, Pamela Burton. Now, what I loved about this is they sewed together about 30 different little snippets of conversation where she's talking about her entire career, how she started out in school, who her influences were, who her teachers were, the activities that her teachers were having her do that really helped shape the way that she interacted with the natural world. She talks about taking a break from her college education and helping a friend in a studio. That was fascinating. She talks about going to Japan as a very young woman and the influence of seeing nature, seeing all of those beautiful gardens and natural elements in Japan and the impact that had on her career. Anyway, I thought this video was fantastic. I put it in the Facebook group for the show. You can find it there. And if you want to find it quickly, just head on up to the magnifying glass when you're in the group, search for the word Pam, and this video will pop right up. So just a few resources, video resources, for you to check out the next time you're on Facebook. And speaking of Facebook, I'm sure that you, like me, have been watching the news and hearing what the Facebook whistleblower has been saying and how negative content is so powerful and destructive. And so I just wanted to mention for a second that if you're in the Facebook group for the show, all you're going to see in there are garden articles or garden-related posts. So there's no spam. I'm not doing anything with your information. It's really just a community for listeners of the show to get together. And while we're talking about this, I also wanted to point out that I am on Twitter. Now, what I do on Twitter is I follow people that are in the horticulture space, that are ecologists or naturalists or professors or work at botanical gardens. So the feed that I follow is really limited to those folks. And that has made Twitter a very positive experience for me. So for what it's worth, that has been my approach to social media, and that's primarily how I use it. I really limit what I'm looking at online. Okay, quick update on the cabin. I think I called 10, 12 landscape folks yesterday, and I am down to one. Obi-Wan Kenobi, my only hope. We'll see if he can help me out at the garden up in Wyoming. And if not, we're going to have to get all that done on our own. So it could be a very, very busy month. We'll see how things pan out. But yesterday, I was going through the edge of the woods that's on the south side of the property. And when I'm outside, Max is always out there with me. And I was tidying up along the edge of the property there. And for the last couple of years, I've let it go a little bit wild. And so I was working in there. I was pulling down actually some grapevine that was in the trees. And I had this 20-foot section of grapevine that I'm tugging on, trying to get it out. And I looked at Max, and he loves tug of war. And I said, Max, come on over here. And I gave him this grapevine. And I'm not kidding, he pulled the grapevine out of the tree. So I was like cheering for him. I'm like, thank you, buddy. That was awesome. But it's fun sometimes to get your dog to help you in the garden. It's too bad he doesn't know how to install a fire pit. And now he's looking at me. Oh, Max, you are great as is. All right, one last thing really quickly here. My copy just arrived of Louise Dickinson Rich's book called We Took to the Woods. Now, if you're looking for a special Christmas present, something that you don't have to worry about finding on Amazon or getting shipped to your house in time, just look over on used book websites, whether it's eBay or Abe Books, whatever your preferred used book vendor is, and search for this book, We Took to the Woods, because the cover is beautiful. It'll look great by a bedside. It'll look wonderful by your favorite reading chair in January and February. Imagine a book cover that shows a snowy landscape, trees in the foreground, a cabin tucked in the back, and then in red lettering, We Took to the Woods. And here's what it says on the book jacket to entice you. Louise Dickinson would say, when asked what she was going to do with her life, that she was going to live alone in a cabin in the Maine woods and write. Years later, when she received a letter from a friend exclaiming, "Isn't it wonderful that you're at last doing what you always wanted?" she realized with a start that she was living her old dream. And that's the introduction to this book. And like I say, it's very, very pretty. So I'm glad I got my copy here. And this little guy is going to be one of the books that I'm reading this month. And then it will just be sitting out for the winter because it's that pretty. So there's another little lead for you on a good book that you can source for yourself or for a friend. All right, it's time for today's curated news. Okay, today's curated news comes from House and Garden, and it's Nicola Harding's tips for outdoor dining. I could talk about this all day. We could just do a whole show on outdoor dining. I love looking at these pictures and getting some inspiration. Nicola offers some really great tips here. And she starts out with something that I thought was a little different than what I have traditionally read about outdoor dining spaces. She says, If you have enough space, I suggest positioning a dining area slightly away from the house. Now, isn't that different than what we've traditionally heard? Because like with the kitchen garden, I've usually read that your dining space should be close to the house so you don't have to traipse so far to get there. So the point that Nicola is making that yes, you do want it to be convenient, but you don't want to have your table and chairs and all this stuff cluttering up your view or your walking paths when you're first trying to get out of the house. So point taken, I loved that concept. And so the other thing that she brings up is the fact that year one or two, your garden furniture looks great and it's so pretty and everybody wants to be out there. And then in the ensuing years, if you don't take care of it, it can look really ratty and old in no time, especially with Minnesota winters. I don't know where you live, if your garden furniture is able to last for years and years without going bad. But up here, you got to have constant maintenance. You got to make sure that you're weatherproofing it regularly, you're washing it, you're taking care of it. And I suppose it just goes with being outside. So I liked this point from her about moving that area a little bit away from the house. And I suppose the other reason that I like it is I'm thinking about the cabin. So we've got this fire pit that you're going to walk into when you first walk out of the house, and then closer to the lake on this elevated kind of platform that I'm making is going to be the dining area with the Pottery Barn table that I got for free. I can't believe it, a couple of summers ago. It's beautiful, and there it sits. It's a queen waiting for its throne, and so we're going to put that together this fall, God willing, time permitting. Please hold off snow. Please, please, please. Now, Nicola shares a ton of other great tips here. One is to have power near your dining area, which is so true, because occasionally you do need to have electricity if you're gonna keep things warm or you need lighting, that kind of a thing. She talks about having things serve two purposes. For a while in her own garden, she used her potting bench as her dining table. And so part of the year it looked like a potting bench, and then when she needed it to be a dining table, she would clear all of that off and then use it for dining, for getting friends together and having something to eat out in the garden. So anyway, lots of great tips here for outdoor dining and for making that a special place that you want to go when you're out in your garden. Okay, so if you'd like to track down this post by Nicola Harding, you can find it in the Facebook group. Just search for the word dining. You knew that was coming, and this post will pop right up. If you're not in the Facebook group, come on in and join us. It's totally free. It's all about gardening. There's no spam and tons of great people. You might make some new friends in that group. All you need to do to join is head on up to the search bar where you'd search for a friend, type in the words Daily Gardener Community, and then there are three questions that you need to answer. I read those, so if you want to send me a little message, you can do that in the last question. Just say, hey, I listened to the show. Here's my thoughts. That'd be great. I will let you into the group, and we will talk about gardening in there together. All right, it's time for today's botanical history. Here's botanical history for today, October 5th. Today is the birthday of Joachim Patinir. He was a Flemish Renaissance painter of history, religion, and landscape. And he was born on this day, October 5th, in 1524. Joachim worked primarily in Antwerp, and he's credited with creating landscape painting as an independent subject. His scenes are imaginary, and his world landscape offers a panoramic view with craggy rocks and boulders jutting out of a cliff on one side and partially obscuring the view. Then he usually included small figures that portrayed religious events. And once you've seen some of his art, you'll be able to identify it. His use of vibrant colors and little details set in sweeping landscapes is actually quite mesmerizing. And today is the birthday of William Hamilton Gibson. He was born on this day in 1850, and he was an American illustrator, author, and naturalist. He was born in Sandy Hook, Connecticut. William grew up with an immediate love of the natural world that his parents nurtured, especially his mother. And when he was 10 years old, his parents sent him to a boarding school called the Gunn School for advanced training. Now, Frederick Gunn was the founder of the school. He loved the natural world, and he incorporated the study of nature into the academic teachings of the school. So it was right up William's alley. And so William gets sent to the Gunn School as a 10-year-old. And in no time, he's sending notes home to his parents, to his mom. And here's a little excerpt from one of the letters that he wrote her. He wrote, "I have just found an imperial mothworm on a maple tree. Will you please look on one of the small apple trees in the orchard near the place where the arbor used to be? There is a tree on which I put a cecropia worm for myself. I think a great deal of it, or I wouldn't write about it. The boys are leaving from here very fast, and we will all leave in 13 days more." He was eager to get home. And then he included this little postscript. "That worm that I told you about is on the apple tree. If very large, must be taken off and put into a box with fresh apple leaves every day. If small, do the same." That's so cute. He's telling his mom what to do with this moth worm. Totally something that a young budding naturalist would say. And his mom would write him back, and she would do what most moms do. She was writing him back and talking to him about what he was passionate about. So she wrote to him, and she was talking about worms and trees and the garden and nature. So she was feeding this interest that he had. In another note that he wrote to his mom, he ended with this little offer that I thought was so cute. And as the mother of three sons, I could totally see one of my boys offering something similar. So here's what he wrote. "In a garden up here, there's a kind of columbine, very large, of two kinds, purple and white, and very large." He says that twice. And then he writes, "I am welcome to all the seed that I want, and I don't know whether you want any or not, but nevertheless, I'll get you a lot. Your affectionate son, Willie." Isn't that sweet? Well, at the Gunn School, William was able to study all aspects of the natural world, even botany as a subject, something that, as we know, just doesn't happen. Botany is not in schools, and it really wasn't prevalent in schools in the early 1900s either. And so William benefited from being surrounded by this immersive nature school. And he knew it. But he also knew that you didn't have to go far to find nature, and that there was plenty of nature, even in small areas. And so here is something that he wrote in a letter, and it's about the nature that you can find just in examining a single fallen tree. Here's what he wrote. "My scientific friend recently informed me that he had spent 2 days most delightfully and profitably in the study of a single dead tree, and was surprised to learn that 100 distinct species of plants congregated upon it. Plumy dicentra clustered along its length, graceful sprays of the frost flower with its little spire of snow crystals rose up here and there. Scarlet berries of the Indian turnip glowed among the leaves, and with the lycopediums and mosses, ferns and lichens, and a host of fungus growths, it was easy to extend the list of species into the second hundred. It is something worth remembering the next time we go into the woods. Well, this little young naturalist, William Gibson, ends up as an adult living in, of all places, Brooklyn. I'm not kidding. And he unfortunately started out in a soul-crushing job selling insurance until the day that he tried to sell insurance to a draftsman. And he ends up spending the entire day watching this guy draw, and he decides immediately that day to pivot, and he begins to pursue an art career. And his very first gig was drawing feathers for Harper Brothers magazine. Somebody had written about birds and different feathers, and so he was the guy that they tapped to draw the feathers. And the very first drawing that he submitted was this iconic drawing of a peacock feather. In fact, I love it so much, I'm going to print it out and just keep it in my botanical library. It's just that good. And it was so good for him because it sealed his fate as an illustrator. He was off to the races. And once William began writing, he experienced the same thing. He became immediately recognized as a very good nature writer. Now, one of William's favorite places to write in Brooklyn was a wild corner of Prospect Park. And it was there that he enjoyed this rare oasis of flora and fauna, unlike any other green space in the city. But when the city sought to clean up the wild space by cutting down trees and removing plants, that was their plan, William took action, and he wrote articles for the newspaper and persuaded local leaders to see Prospect Park from his perspective and to point out what the city stood to lose if they took this action. Well, the city ended up reversing course, and William Hamilton Gibson became known as the man who saved Prospect Park. What a great legacy. And today is also the birthday of an American botanist named Merritt Lyndon Fernald, who was born on this day in 1873. Merritt wrote over 800 papers, and he co-authored a book called Edible Wild Plants of Eastern North America. It took him 2 years to write it, and guess who he wrote it with? He wrote it with the American scientist and sexologist Alfred Kinsey. Yes, he did. Now, on Twitter, I happened to stumble on one of his herbarium sheets. He had collected a pink blooming azalea, and right below the specimen, he wrote the words of a little poem, and it was all about the rhodora, this little pink blooming azalea that's found in the northeastern part of the United States. After I deciphered his handwriting, which I think I got right, here's what he wrote. The gay rhodora long the margin stands, forerunner of the summer's fairer rose. Yet coming as she does to ope spring's lands, she brightens every mood wherein she blows. It's time for today's Unearthed Words. Today's Unearthed Words come to us from Barbara Kingsolver, the author of the fabulous book, Animal Vegetable Miracle, A Year of Food Life. And this is an excerpt where she's talking about watermelon. Our gardening forebears meant watermelon to be the juicy, barefoot taste of a hot summer's end, just as pumpkin is the trademark fruit of late October. Most of us accept the latter and limit our jack-o'-lantern activities to the proper botanical season. Waiting for a watermelon is harder. It's tempting to reach for melons, red peppers, tomatoes, and other late summer delights before the summer even arrives. But it's actually possible to wait, celebrating each season when it comes, not fretting about its being absent at all other times, because something else good is at hand. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, Durr's Encyclopedia of Trees and Shrubs by Michael A. Durr. I know yesterday I talked about a Michael Durr book. I think tomorrow I have another one queued up. So what do you know? It's a week of celebrating Michael Durr. Now, this particular book is one of his that came out in 2011, and it is a hefty, hefty boy. It's a gem of a resource. As I said at the top of the show, it is a must-have monster resource for gardeners. It has over 3,500 photographs of over 3,700 species and cultivars of trees and shrubs. Michael covers thousands of plants in this very detailed book, from flowering shrubs to weeping trees. And the photos not only show the trees and shrubs in all their glory, but they also show these magnificent plants in winter and in other seasons to help make identification and selection 100% accurate. So this is another book that you're going to want to throw in your truck and keep it there so that when you're at the garden center, you've got it and you can point out what you're looking for. Now, this book is an excellent resource for gardeners, landscape architects, designers, and anyone who wants the Bible for trees and shrubs. And lest you think that this is a boring book, you would be so wrong, because Michael is very clever, his descriptions are fresh, and he's pretty funny, and he incorporates that humor into his work. This book is 952 pages. It's a big one, of Trees and Shrubs by a respected plantsman who writes with passion, candor, and wit about every possible aspect of these plants. Flower color, fall color, salt or shade tolerance, winter interest, and form. Just to name a few of the aspects that he covers. You can get a copy of Durr's Encyclopedia of Trees and Shrubs by Michael Durr and support the show using the Amazon link in today's show notes for around $37. And if you think about that cost amortized over all of those pages, it really is a deal. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. Today is the birthday of Denis Diderot. He was the French philosopher, art critic, and writer, and he was born on this day, October 15th, in 1713. Denis was an ordinary man. He was a common man. He was not part of the aristocracy like his contemporary Voltaire. And after he started to work on the very first encyclopedia in France, he was imprisoned, punished for claiming that knowledge came from our senses and not from God. Well, in this way, and in many others, Denis Diderot challenged the church and the state, but he learned to be a little more discreet with his criticisms over time. And his industry and his success afforded him some protection and propelled his work into existence. Now, Denis's concept for his encyclopedia was to gather together the brightest minds of his time and to create a series of books that shared standard academic fare, like philosophy and literature, along with everyday jobs in the crafts and trades. And this is what made it truly unique, because that type of information had never been captured, and by including it in his encyclopedia, he elevated the people's work. Now, some of the work that he wrote about was horticultural and floral. For instance, he featured the work of artificial flower makers, a fascinating job, and market gardeners. And today, if you look on Etsy or other places, you'll notice that the pages in his encyclopedia where he illustrated these types of jobs are now popular pieces of art. People make copies of it, blow it up, and then display it in their homes. They're that pretty. Now, speaking of art, Diderot was a huge admirer, not only of tradespeople, but of all artisans and art. But he was also a tough critic. He had high standards. He said, "First of all, move me, surprise me, rend my heart, make me tremble, weep, shudder, outrage me. Delight my eyes afterwards if you can." And then he ends with this advice: "Whatever the art form, it is better to be extravagant than cold." Well, in the end, Denis Diderot's 28-volume encyclopedia took him 26 years to complete, and it featured work from over 100 writers covering over 71,000 entries and 20 million words. And although it was banned by both King Louis XV of France and the Vatican, the Pope was not amused. Diderot's encyclopedia was a huge success, and the adversity that Diderot faced led to his famous saying that a book banned is a book read. Today, the Diderot Encyclopedia is considered one of the great works of the European Enlightenment. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener, and remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Maple Grove and Wyoming, Minnesota. If you want to read today's show notes, just head on over to thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. And don't forget that you have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for listeners of the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. Last but not least, you can always get in touch by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you tomorrow.